Hallelujah.
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things. To you are all things. You deserve the glory. You are worthy of it.
And expectation. As we go into your word, we pray, O God, that your word will do us good. Pray, Lord, that you will gather understanding from your word. And Lord, even as I share that which you have laid on my heart, I ask, O God, that you anoint me to bring forth this word in a way that your people will understand and in a way that will glorify you. I ask you to take control, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The topic of today's sermon is expressions of love through worship. Expressions of love through worship. And of course, when I say expressions of love through worship, I mean expressing our love towards God. Amen. So in the Bible, and I'm talking about the King James version here, because I can't say for certain it's the same in other versions. The first time the word worship occurs is in Genesis 22, verse 5. Genesis 22, verse 5. And that says, "And Abraham said unto his young men, Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Otiti is preaching with me today. And you will see here that in this first occurrence of the word worship, there is no mention of singing or music, is there? Did you notice any of that? No. The context around this verse is Abraham, you know the story. Abraham believed God for a child for 25 years. And finally, this child of promise came. And here God is telling Abraham to sacrifice this child of promise, something that was most dear to him, most precious to him. God said he should go and lay that child on the altar and sacrifice him. And that is what led to this comment by Abraham, that the men should abide and that he will go yonder and to worship. And in that, we can see evidence or a pointer to what true worship is. True worship is when you are able to lay down everything, the most precious thing, you are able to lay it down. It's a principle of God-centeredness, putting God first. Worship is something that should be reserved for God and God only. So we see in Exodus 34:14, God said, "For thou shalt worship no other God. For the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God." In Mark 12:30, Jesus says, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment." So we can see here the entirety of our being is what we use to worship God. Amen? It's not just about singing. It's not just about music. Music is a way, it's one of the ways we can express our worship to God. But music, singing is not worship. The worship comes from the heart. So what does it mean to worship God? What does it mean to worship God? When we talk about worship, we're talking about something that we give our utmost, our highest attention to. I know that if I were to ask us before what is worship, most of us will make reference to music. As I say, music is not worship. It's something, although we use music to express our worship at times. To worship is to value something or someone above everything else. Worship is when we give our deepest affection and highest praise to something or someone. You can describe worship as giving someone or something our first love or our highest love. So if you recall in the book of Revelation when Jesus was speaking to the seven churches, his rebuke to the church at Ephesus, we see that in Revelation 2 verse 4. He said, "Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love." What does that mean? That means that something that they held in the highest regard before had now become secondary or tertiary. It was no longer the utmost of the highest point of affection for that church. So that's what we call the first love. What is it that is most precious to us? In effect, that is what we worship. Jesus described loving God as the first commandment. So what does it mean to worship God? Number one, worship is acknowledging the holiness of God. Worship is acknowledging the holiness of God. When we talk about personal holiness, personally, we are often referring to a purity or righteousness, righteous living. But God's holiness is not limited to purity and righteousness. It refers to God's, if you can use the word, separateness. He is unique. He's all by himself. There's nothing that compares to him. He's full of majesty. He's full of splendor. He's superior to anything else that there can be. He's different. That is God by all himself. That's God. He's all by himself. He's holy. There's nothing you can use to describe him. So when there's no words to say, we just say, holy, holy, holy. Worship is like a wow moment, you know? That moment, then we just think, wow. It's a spiritual wow. That is worship. That is what worship is. Psalm 99, verse 5 and 9. Psalm 99, verses 5 and 9. Says, exalt ye the Lord our God and worship at his footstool, for he is holy. For he is wow. He is, I can't even describe him. The words that we have in our vocabulary cannot describe him. Amen? Verse 9 of Psalm 99 says, exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill. For the Lord our God is holy. Our Lord our God is holy. 1 Chronicles 16:29, the B part, adjures us to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. What does that mean? You know what I do to make me to understand it better? I kind of turn it around a little bit as if to say, the beauty of holiness makes me to worship the Lord. You know, that's just something I did for my own better understanding. Instead of me reading it as worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness, I now turn it around to say, because of the beauty of the holiness, because I behold his holiness, I worship the Lord. Amen? So it is an acknowledgement of the holiness of God. Romans 15 verse 4 says, who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou art holy. For all nations shall come before you and worship before thee. For thy judgments are made manifest. Psalm 22 verse 3 says, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. So worship is acknowledging the holiness of God. There's no blemish in him. There is no darkness in him. There is no flaw in him. There is no weakness in him. There's nothing wrong about him. That is acknowledging the holiness of God. And when you see that, when that clicks, when we have that revelation, it moves us to worship. Number two, worship is our response to God revealing himself to us. Worship is our response to God revealing himself to us. It is expressing how much we value the presence of God. When we contemplate the greatness, the infinity, the incomparability, the magnificence, the sovereignty, the vastness of God, our response is worship. An example of an outburst of worship we can see in Romans 11 from verse 33. This is Paul writing. After he'd spoken about a number of things in Romans 11, and he got to verse 33, and he says, oh, the depth of the riches of both the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been his counselor, or who hath first given to him, and it shall not be recompensed unto him again? For of him, and through him, and to him are all things, to be glory forever and ever. Amen. When we have that just, you know, when it clicks in our souls at times, the mightiness of God, and sometimes we have to be reminded because we are mere flesh and circumstances, busyness, all those kind of things cloud our minds. But sometimes in God's mercy, he allows us to encounter, to have that revelation of how great and mighty and powerful and faultless and blameless and blemishless he is. And our response is what? We worship is, wow, wow, what an awesome God. Hallelujah. And it is not just about when we sing. Hallelujah. Moses made a request to God in Exodus 33, verse 18. Exodus 33, 18. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. That was a plea that Moses made to God. And then we read from Exodus 34, verse 5 to 8. Exodus 34, 5 to 8. It says, and the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with them there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for generations, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children, unto the third and to the fourth generation. And what was Moses' response? And Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth, and he worshipped. So that was his response to encountering the glory of God. He worshipped. Amen? Number three, worship is an attitude and a posture. Worship is an attitude and a posture. It's not just physical, but all of the heart. So unlike thanksgiving and praise, which are primarily utterances, we thank God verbally. We praise God verbally. Amen? Worship is not just verbal. It's also an attitude. It's not just verbal. It's also an attitude. Amen? It is an attitude of our whole inner being. There are examples of physical attitudes or postures in worship in Scripture. We can see some. Genesis 24:26. It says, and the man bowed his head and worshipped the Lord. So that's an example of a posture in worship. Bowing the head. Psalm 95, verse 6. It says, oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. So kneeling is another posture in worship. Revelation 7:11 says, and all the angels stood round about the throne and about the elders and the four beasts and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God. What does it mean to fall on our faces? It means to prostrate, faces down. You may have seen people in worship doing that before. That's in Scripture. To fall on one's face means to lie prostrate. And all these postures can be adopted by our hearts. So you remember that song, casting crowns, lifting hearts, bowing hearts, is how we want to do. This is where my co-preacher comes into play. Adonai, you reign on high. We will rise in your name, Adonai, you reign on high. So that's a casting crowns. It's a posture, bowing hearts. Bowing hearts. So we're not just bowing physically, we're bowing in our hearts. Amen. Worship is simply being in awe of God, an attitude of reverence. Amen? I said before, worship can be described as our spiritual wow. So I want us to look at Isaiah 6, verses 1 to 5. Isaiah 6, verses 1 to 5. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face. With twain he covered his feet. And with twain he did fly. That means two. Twain means two. And one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried. And the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, and I want you to listen to this. When he encountered and saw the holiness of God, the awesomeness of God, what did he say? He said, woe is me, for I am undone. Because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. So when we behold the presence of God and we compare ourselves to that, we feel so inadequate. We seem so small. We seem so insignificant. When we compare ourselves to the splendor of God, what does it cause us to do? To worship. We just go, wow. Wow, God, you are awesome. You are incredible, indescribable. You are unlimited. That is worship. And it takes a revelation of who God is for us to get to that place. Amen? We see a similar situation with David in Psalm 8 from verse 1. Psalm 8. It says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Who has set thy glory above the heavens? Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightst steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider the heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Can you just imagine how he was feeling? He looked at all the things that God had created. He spoke into being, the mountains, the sea, all the creative acts of God. And then he compared himself to all of that might and majesty. And he says, what is man? What am I that you are mindful of me, and the son of man that you visit me? For you have made me a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned me with glory and honor. You made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passeth through the parts of the sea. And when he considered that, he just said again, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. That is worship. When we get to that place where we just see nothing but the splendor of the Most High God. Hallelujah. So how do we worship God? There is a protocol. There's a pattern for worship. Psalm 132, verse 7, says we will go into his tabernacles. Psalm 132, verse 7, says we will go into his tabernacles. We will worship at his footstool. So what are his tabernacles? A tabernacle means a dwelling place. Could you help me put that thing on the screen now, please? So that I can show you what a tabernacle is. If we can show it, so if you scroll up to where the pattern is, yeah, there, okay. So I'll show you what a tabernacle is. If you can dim the lights, yes, please, so that I can just show you. So this is what a tabernacle is. When the children of Israel were in the wilderness, this was the place where they met with God. And the tabernacle is this. So you can see here, this is the gates of the tabernacle. Can you see that? Those are the gates of the tabernacle. The tent is what surrounded the walls surrounded the tabernacle, and this is the east gate where the children of Israel, they entered in to this place, which is called the court of the tabernacle. In that court, that is where all the sacrifices took place. All the bulls and rams were sacrificed here. Then you have a laver here where the priests used to wash their hands. And then in the tent, this is the tent where they call it the tent of meeting. There are two parts to that tent. The first part is called the holy place. And that holy place is the place where only the priests could go. Then in that tent, there's something called a veil. A veil. And that veil separated the holy place to the most holy place. So through that tabernacle, you can see there's a concept of a progressive approach to where God is. It was believed the Ark of the Covenant was in that most holy place, and it was believed that the presence of God rested on the mercy seat on the Ark of the Covenant. So it was believed that the presence of God was in the Holy of Holies. So you had to go through the gates into the courts, and then from the courts, the priest could go into the holy place, and then the priest only went into the most holy place once a year. But that's where the Ark of the Covenant was, and that's where the presence of God was. Amen? Does that make sense? That's a quick explanation of what that tabernacle was. So, why is that relevant? God gave instructions to Moses on how to build the tabernacle. Now, that tabernacle was a temporary place of worship. Each time that the children of Israel moved, you know, they were in the wilderness, they were going towards the promised land, they had to dismantle it, carry it, and rebuild it wherever they settled. So it was a temporary place of worship. When it now came to the days of David, David now said, we'll see this in 2 Samuel 7, 1-2. When they got to the promised land, 2 Samuel verse 7 from verse 1, David said, and it came to pass when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. So David was saying, look, I'm a king, I'm a human being, I'm living in a house built of wood. Yet the presence of God is in a tent, in a tent. He didn't think that was appropriate. So God wanted to, can we switch off our phones, please? It's a bit distracting. Amen. So he was saying that God was dwelling in a tent. How can he be dwelling in a house? Anyway, what then happened is that God said, okay, David desired to build this house, but God said, look, you've shed too much blood. Okay, can I just remind us, when we're coming into service, let's have our phones off or silent, please. Let's not distract the service while we're here. God does not contact us through our mobile phone. Now that so where was I? 2 Samuel, and it came to pass when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see, now I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth with curtains. But God wouldn't allow David to build it because he said he had too much bloodshed. But Solomon, he said his son Solomon would build it. And the temple of Solomon was built after David had died. David made provision for all of that. But the structure, that progressive approach to the presence of God, was also infused into how the building was built. So you see that you have the different sections, the outer court, the holy place, and the most holy place. Some of you might, if you go to these liturgical churches, traditional churches, you will see that layout. So you see the court where the people sit. Then you see the priests have you noticed that some of those places, they have two parts to their altar? There's one part where the priest sits, he does the elements and all that, and there's one part that is further out that is meant to represent the Holy of Holies. Amen? So what is the relevance of all of that for us? Psalm 100 gives us further understanding on the concept of progressive approach into God's presence. Psalm 100, let's read from verse 4. Psalm 100, verse 4. Says, enter his gates with thanksgiving. So we saw the gates. David is saying, when we're approaching God in worship, the first thing is we enter his courts, his gates, with thanksgiving. So that's where we thank God for his goodness. Amen. Then the next step is we enter his courts with what? Enter into his courts with praise. So that is where we acknowledge God's greatness. when he for the greatness, the things that we see, the work of his hands, we give him praise. Then it goes on to say, be thankful for him and bless his name, for the God is good and his mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. So we see two stages of access towards God there. Psalm 48 verse 1 says, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. So when we're worshiping, we're dealing with the holiness of God. So the thanksgiving is we're acknowledging his goodness. We praise, we're acknowledging his greatness. In worship, we're acknowledging his holiness. So his holiness is, he's incomparable. There's nothing we can describe him to. Amen? So we cannot get to the point of worship without first having a heart of thanksgiving and a heart of praise. It's impossible. If you are not grateful to God, if you cannot see the work of his hands, you can't praise, you can't even start to approach worship. Because worship is just your overall, really. That's where you're getting to. Amen? Psalm 116. I read verses 12 and 14. Psalm 116, 12 to 14. It says, what shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits towards me? I will take the cup of salvation. First of all, the cup of salvation. The fact that he saved me from destruction. The fact that Jesus actually granted me access to the Most High God, that he tore the veil away. That's the first entry point. Amen. I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of his people. I will offer to thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vow now in the presence of the people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of thee, O Jerusalem. Praise ye the Lord. So we see thanksgiving and we see praise. We see progress. There's this progressive protocol again in Psalm 95, verses 1 to 7. Psalm 95, 1 to 7. Says, O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. So that's the first thing. And make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. In his hands are the deep places of the earth. The strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. What is he doing here? He's praising him. He's praising him for his greatness, for what he has done, for what you can see. The mountains, he's talking about the seas, talking about the dry land. And what is the culmination of the thanksgiving and praise? In verse 6, it says, oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice. Now, I want us to roll forward 1,000 years to the coming of Jesus Christ. So all that we could see in the Old Testament, Jesus now came on the earth, and his path crossed that of a Samaritan woman. In John 4, verses 19 to 26. So this is the Samaritan woman. You would have known, we should be familiar with this story. She was the woman at the well, and Jesus asked that, could she draw water for him? And she went to the well, and Jesus said, if you knew who was asking you, you would ask for the living water. And then the woman said unto him, from verse 19, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Remember, he had revealed to her that she'd already had five husbands. And to that she said, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto you, I am he. Amen. We worship in spirit and in truth. Towards the end, the woman said, I know that the Messiah is coming, which is called Christ. And when he comes, he will tell us all these things. What is Jesus saying to her? Jesus said, don't worry about him coming. He's here now. This is the time. I am here. So all those things that you're expecting, I am bringing a new dispensation of worship. That is what God is saying. So what do we learn from the points that were raised here by Jesus to this Samaritan woman? We will go into that next time. Amen. We will go into that next time because we don't have enough time to do it now. So as God gives us the opportunity, we will go into what does that mean to us as believers, New Testament believers? How does that impact our worship? How does it connect to the pattern of worship that was given in the New Testament? Remember that it is not just about music. It is a heart attitude that is worship. Hallelujah. I want us to sing this song, When the Music Fades and All is Stripped Away. Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet. Hallelujah. When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more, I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back, I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all It's all about you.
It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
I want us to pray that the Lord should bring us back to that place of worship. The ability to worship even without the music, without a song, that we shall behold his glory wherever we are. You know, you cannot even begin to worship if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, because he's the one who tore the veil that separated the holy place from the most holy, and God resided in the most holy place. You are unable to worship God if you cannot get into his presence. And the only way into his presence is through our Lord Jesus Christ. So if there's anyone here or anyone who's listening or watching online, if you have not made Jesus Christ the center of your life, the one who saved you, who died to set you free from the penalty of sin, if you have not invited him into your life, I want to ask you to take this opportunity to invite him into your life right now. I will ask that you pray this prayer with me and all of us who are here. Let's pray this together. Let's say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sin. I acknowledge that you died on the cross, and by the shedding of your blood, you washed away my sin. I believe that God raised you from the dead. And I confess in my heart right with my mouth right now that you are the Lord of all. I invite you to come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior from this day forward in Jesus' mighty name. Come and be my Lord. Change my life around. In Jesus' name I pray. And let's pray that God will take us to that place of true worship where we will behold his majesty, where he will be the center of our focus, that all our works, all our efforts will flow from that place of worship. Let's ask, let him take us to that place. Perhaps we have experienced it before and we no longer experience it. Help, ask him to help us to restore our first love. Lord, we want to be in that place of true worship, that place of true worship. Take us back to that place where we first met you, where all our focus, all our passions, all our attentions were upon you. Take us to that place, Lord. Take us to that place. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we are thankful for the access to the most holy place. Lord, as we continue on our journey with you, we pray, Lord, that we'll be able to offer you pure worship. Worship that has you at the center of it all. Father God, to you be all the glory. To you be all the honor. In Jesus' name. As time permits, we will go into the next stage. But for now, just enter that, understand that approach. And I pray that it will start to understand how that impacts our worship of God. Hallelujah. Amen.